So the Prime Minister has finally bit the bullet. He announced the creation of the Office of Chief of Defence Staff in his Independence Day address from the Red Fort on the 15th of August. Now to discuss this momentous decision, we have with us General Subroto Saha. General, why is this such a big deal? Why is the creation of the post of Chief of Defence Staff integral to the process of defence reform, of the reorganisation of higher defence management? And how is this different from the permanent Chairman Chiefs of Staff, which was being talked about earlier?
Firstly, thanks for having me for this conversation. It is a big deal because of the way the warfare is, you know, moving forward. And today, whether you look at it in the context of conventional war, whether you look at it in the context of hybrid war, and if you were to add to this nuclear war, yes. I mean, gone are the days of, you know, single service fighting wars. Yes. So for the kind of threats that are evolving, for the kind of environment in which the forces have to operate, it is, I think, an extremely important step to have been able to get the forces together. And if you recall from the Prime Minister's speech yesterday, the Prime Minister also, you know, brought out quite categorically that our services are doing a great job, but it is important to have better coordination amongst themselves. And I think that's the key, is better coordination. One is, of course, from war fighting point of view, and the other important facet is war preparation point of view. I mean, when you do the force development in terms of, you know, equipping your forces, in terms of training the forces, yes. in terms of articulating your doctrines for the future. So all of it today requires much better coordination. And it is not as if it was not happening in the past, but the arrangements were at best ad hoc. I mean, if you see some books which are written by former service chiefs of 1971 war, the Air Chief, for example, he very categorically praises the tri-service, you know, integration that was there during 71. But obviously, post the Kargil, when the Kargil Review Committee highlighted the importance of institutionalizing it quite clearly, they would have picked it up from the way things have happened. So A, it is important for the way we are going to fight wars in the future. So that's what makes it, you know, big deal. Second, that it has taken the country 20 years to take this decision. So I take it that it couldn't have been, you know, debated back and forth more than this. So at the end of it, when it has been done, achieved, as we are, you know, going forward to become a $5 trillion economy, you better be undergirded by strong security. And that strong security, quite clearly, will come from this momentous decision.
If it's such an obvious evolution in the reform of higher defence management, why has it taken 20 years, as you were just alluding to? We know that the Subramaniam Committee, the Kargil Review Committee, recommended this 2 decades ago. The Arun Singh Committee reiterated it. And the group of ministers in 2001 also appeared to agree. Why has it taken so long? And I will also request you to refer to the opposition, both from the political bureaucratic establishment as also the legacy of Air Force opposition to the creation of post Chief of Defence Staff.
Okay, many questions rolled into one. If you know, go back and trace the evolution. Like you mentioned, it was there in the Kargil Review Committee, the high-level committee. Yes. It was there in the group of ministers. Mm-hmm. But when that task force, Naresh Chandra task force, yes. put it out, it was mellowed down from a chairman defense staff, from a CDS, to a permanent chairman Chiefs of Staff Committee.
Was that a poor compromise?
So, exactly. So, you know, this going back and forth does reflect the dilemma which was there in all the establishments. Yes. I mean, I'm not going to start, you know, apportioning it as a political dilemma or a bureaucratic reluctance or a lack of consensus among the three services. I think everyone had their share of responsibility in this prolonged delay which has taken place. So now that that is over, I think it's important that it is taken forward in the right earnest and the right spirit with which the Prime Minister said, to make it more better coordinated and more effective as we go into the future.
Absolutely. Sir, the services we've seen have been operating in insular silos despite the setting up of some integrated structures post the recommendation of the Kargil Review Committee. There is no substantive integration in terms of either resources or capabilities, much less of having a joint operational philosophy. There are also insular fiscal allocations in the budget. So how is the appointment of a chief of defense staff going to change all that?
Well, to be fair to the services, I won't go to the extreme of saying that they operate in silos. You see, every time there is a humanitarian, you know, disaster, you see how all the three services come together, right? For that matter, if you see the recent operations that have taken place, as the airstrikes were going into Balakot, it is no secret that the army was very much on the alert all along the line of control, perhaps in other areas, and so was the Indian Navy. We have seen that all, you know, progressively coming out. And even if you see, for the first time when the services came out for the media interaction, all the three services were present to put out what they were doing. So, but then, yes, I take your point to the extent that, yes, it was not institutionalized the way it ought to be have been done. Yes. What had happened is, post the, you know, group of ministers recommendations, it was implemented but half-hearted. They created that IDS, integrated defense staff, without a head, so to speak. It was being run by a CISC, and we've seen it. Well, without going too much, you know, lamenting and whining over the past, the point is, okay, let's look at it positively. Now that this IDS has been in function, has been in place for almost a decade and a half, or maybe a little more, it has been grounded, you know, well enough to be sure that this transition to the CDS takes place
So, so what should be the mandate for the Chief of Defence Staff? Should it be a command mandate where he's the apex of the command structure for the forces, or should it be a staff responsibility where he is responsible for the future planning and he introduces jointness in terms of you know, budgeting and procurements? What should be the mandate for the CDS?
You see, effectively, if you want to, you know, simplify the whole requirements, as it were, one is to man, two is to equip, three is to train. Having manned, equipped and trained your force, thereafter you do the operational and logistics, you know, coordination for purposes of applying that force which you have created. Okay, given the way the forces are, and these are very well entrenched procedures which are in place, the transition should be in such a manner that you do not cause a disruption. So this is a personal view. From the point of view of avoiding a disruption and to ensure that you move in a little smoothly into the future, to my mind, there has to be some very clear delineation of these various facets that you talk about. Even if you do the delineation, perforce there will be some blurring, and we'll come to that in a minute. And there are various models, you know, like as early as 1959, UK had adopted the CDS, US adopted it in 1986. And in their case, if you see the case of US, the Chairman Joint Chiefs of Staff is an advisor to the National Security Council, is advisor to the President, and it functions like that. The actual command, the theater commanders, like whether it is PECOM, CENTCOM, whatever they are, they report directly to the Secretary and the President, so to speak. So there are various models that are there. Quite clearly, our model will have to apply to our circumstances as they are, because we don't have our forces, you know, trying to take care of the whole globe. So it will be to suit our requirements. So under these circumstances, if you see, as I look at it, it would make eminent sense to place continue to keep the manning part with the respective service chief. The equipping part will have to come out of a synchronization of the modernization requirements of the three services and further synchronization of that with the budget.
Yes.
So effectively, the prioritization and the budgeting quite clearly would best be handled by the CDS.
Mm-hmm. What about the command function?
Okay, now let's come to the next part. Mm-hmm. Let's come to the training bit. As far as the training is concerned, the training has to be determined by joint doctrines and joint concepts. So therefore, to outline how the forces ought to be trained for the next war or for the other circumstances like hybrid war and all, I think that outlining of the broad strategic, broad policies, broad strategic directions, that is best comes from the CDS. Now let's come to the command bit which I'm describing as the operational and logistics component of the war, right? So for the moment, I think the forces would do well to continue to get their operational directions from their respective service chiefs, but under a broader umbrella of coordination which is provided by the CDS. Okay, it is not as if we don't have experience in this. We have done it in the past without a proper CDS, so to speak. So today a uniformed person fits into that with experience of having been in the forces for so many years to be able to articulate that better.
Okay, so you seem to be suggesting that the command function should stay with the service chiefs for the moment, and maybe we could look at a transition further down the line. Now, in the US, for instance, the service chiefs essentially have a staff role. Now, the various reports or recommendations for the setting up of CDS, they've intended the CDS to be the single as a single point advice, military advice to the cabinet and the prime minister. So if a CDS does not have a command function, would it really be watering down this concept? And should operational instructions to the respective forces, should they be conveyed? Isn't it logical that they be conveyed through the CDS?
You see, I think
operational directives of the government.
Yeah, I think somewhere, you know, we are trying to overdrive. You're trying to overdrive the importance of command. You know, there is a particular significance of the word command at a lower level, and there is a completely different connotation of it at the higher level.
Sure.
Even today, the army chief, for example, is a chief of the army staff. The actual command, even if you go by designation and nomenclatures, general officer commanding in chief,
yes,
the term command gets introduced actually from the theater level.
Yes.
And the same logic is there even with the Navy, with the Air Force.
Yes.
So to that extent, even today when the army chief has to make plans or the naval chief makes his plans, it is very much with the field commanders, you know, on board and through a process of iteration that takes place.
Mm-hmm.
So I really don't see too much of a complication from that point of view, because what would be required is how well do we optimize our resources and apply them on the battlefield.
Mm-hmm.
You know, take typically the case of helicopters, for example.
Mm-hmm.
This is there with all the three services.
Mm-hmm.
Now, how best do you optimize it?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, very recently you've seen, for example, the attack helicopters,
yes,
being assigned to the army,
yes,
and being assigned to the Air Force.
Yes, 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 yes.
So now, moment you have a position of a CDS,
mm-hmm,
clearly you will see how much better utilized,
yes,
the same resources are.
Yes.
You know, and of course we are not
and capabilities.
So I mean this logic.
Could this be amongst the first tests for a CDS?
Absolutely. I mean it's absolutely all those resources which are jointly held, which are jointly procured, you know, all the duplication that takes place,
mm-hmm,
that goes away. I mean, if we were to take it one step forward to logistics, for example,
mm-hmm,
you know, there is so much of potential to integrate, and I say integrate sensibly,
mm-hmm,
logistics of the three services. Sure. And why only through the, for the three services? You look at the way the national infrastructure has developed. Mm-hmm. Look at the way the road connectivities have been achieved. Yes. There is so much potential to bank on civilian logistics mm-hmm. for the purpose of the forces. Now, sure. if the forces don't come together and integrate, how do they take advantage of the civilian infrastructure? So look at the connectivity, for example, sure. the communication connectivity, for example. You heard the Prime Minister talking about, you know, data connectivity down to the last village.
Yes.
So moment you're talking about data connectivity of that kind, mm-hmm. certainly, whether during war or even otherwise, there is scope for the forces to take advantage of that infrastructure and utilize it.
Yes.
And by the same token, even the forces resources which are being earmarked for these for such purposes, mm-hmm. they can be shared with proper security checks, etc., for civilian use. So look at the way how we are able to optimize resources as a nation
yes.
by the creation of an appointment like this.
So is the creation of integrated theater commands the next logical step, sir? How do you see this panning out?
That's an excellent question, and I think it must be there in the mind of every professional mm-hmm. as we speak, because we have 17 such commands,
yes.
all of them at different locations
yes.
with all kinds of ad hoc arrangements like advanced headquarters, TAC headquarters and what have you. So I think the next step would be to see how can we integrate our commands together depending on typically what India's operational requirements are, and we don't have to follow any, I mean, while we get inspired and guided by experience of others, we can clearly evolve our own model, and I think it would make eminent sense to see how can they be combined for optimizing the resources, because after all, resources
so
don't come cheap.
Are we looking at a root and branch reorganization of the military, sir, in the not too distant future?
It has to be an evolutionary process, but the quicker the evolution, the better it is.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to be sure that you're not causing any disruption, mm-hmm. but evolving at a fast enough speed
mm-hmm.
so that you make sure that you make best use of the resources.
Mm-hmm. So the CDS is going to be at the apex of the military hierarchy, so to say. How do you see a new equilibrium arriving in relations with the politico-bureaucratic establishment, and even more important with the NSA, who is the numero uno, so to say, on security matters? How do you see this evolving?
Okay, so let's take the second part first. And to my mind, the NSA is the most empowered and the most eminent person, so to speak, who is in a position to outline what the strategic scenario is, what the geopolitics is, and the strategic threat perception, so to speak, the strategic threat environment, as it were. And once that has been outlined by the NSA, I think the CDS would be ideally positioned to see how to deal with that threat.
Mm-hmm.
And quite clearly, again, it's an interactive process which involves, several ministries.
So you made an important distinction. You said that the NSA would be part of the tasking process and he'd be privy to input from the entire government machinery. And the CDS would be the apex of the implementation infrastructure arrangement that you have. But by the very nature of the appointment, could this erode the power or the area of influence of the National Security Advisor?
Well, I won't call it eroding the powers. Even now, for example,
could there be turf issues?
The NSA is the one who is outlining the threat. He has all the intelligence agencies, keeping him abreast, including the services intelligence and the IDS and what have you. So the DIA and all. So the point is, since he has the complete intelligence picture,
yes,
and of course he is the advisor to the executive head, the prime minister.
This single point military advisor.
Exactly. So one is the intelligence component, the other is the operations component.
Yes.
So I think that is where the two will have to, function together. And typically, this is a very, very interactive process. Even now, for example, if you take it from the point of view of any single service, take the army, for example, there is a military operations and a military intelligence.
Yes.
At the end of it, the two come together and function. So I don't see how we should get dissuaded because of potential turf battles from taking something which is definitely meant to go forward. And likewise, as you are saying, there will be similar challenges within the Ministry of Defence. There will be challenges within the Ministry of Defence because there will be a certain overlap between what, for example, the Defence Secretary is doing today and what the CDS would be expected to do. Today, all the three services requirements, they are just going through a common filter of the IDS. There isn't any inter-service prioritization being done by the IDS. It is going as it is, as a collation of the three services to the Defence Secretary, and he is doing it. So today that function clearly will have to be done by the CDS. So how do the two manage amongst themselves is going to be interesting. In fact, like you spoke about integrated theatre commands, I think we should also be talking about, again, it's one of the recommendations of the Kargil Review Committee and what have you, group of ministers and all, that the Ministry of Defence should have billets which are meant for uniformed people as much as civilian people.
Sure.
And likewise, people of expertise from the civilian side should form part of the service headquarters. Take costing, for example. You know, the Defence Account Services have got people who are there good for auditing, who are there good for financial advice and all.
Yes.
But then you don't see too many costing experts. Mm-hmm. Today, when you make out a procurement case, you need a costing expert. So where does it come from? So I'm giving you one example. There are several such examples where I think if you integrate, if you have both civil and military presence in the service headquarters, in the Ministry of Defence, only then you achieve the true integration.
Sir, as someone who is tasked with rendering single point military advice to the cabinet, is the appointment of the CDS, is this something which could even erode a defense minister's turf, not just a defense secretary's? Because he reports to the cabinet, not just to a defense minister.
The point is, the defense minister is a political person.
Yes.
And here we are talking about single point military advice. Right. So if that military advice were to be given to the cabinet committee, or for that matter the cabinet committee on security, quite clearly it is also there for the defense minister.
Yes.
So it is, I think, for the defense minister to take, you know, advantage of that advice and take it forward. If you go back not too far ago, even I think the Raksha Mantri Mr. Parikar had said that because of the absence of a CDS, there is a lot of, you know, superfluous works that happen, there is duplication that happens. So it is not as if the ministers don't feel the necessity. I mean, today, of course, the Prime Minister has announced it. It has obviously got the consensus of the cabinet. Even in the past, several ministers have felt the necessity of a single point military advice, rather than every time having to go through each of the three services. So it's, I mean, most of the concerns which you're raising are genuine, but I think they are more of transitory concerns than what is meant for the long term.
How would you convince the service chiefs? Would this be amongst the most important tasks for a CDS, that the service turfs won't be diminished in any manner?
Let's put it like this. These are the reasons why, for example, consensus was not coming amongst the service chiefs, right? These are the reasons probably why consensus was not there in several other armed forces of the world. But at the same time, the need was also being put out by the forces themselves every time. I recall, you know, in 1990 when I did my staff college in the UK, we found, I mean, I was quite amazed to see a CDS over there. So when we came back, obviously we kept it in our discussions, recommendations. I'm just giving you a simple example to highlight the point that if you go, for example, to our higher command course or to our higher defense management course, through the year, literally in every lecture, in every discussion that follows lectures, the point that we need a CDS keeps coming on and off. You see how many service chiefs have written after retirement, have written on why, how important it is to have a CDS. So while there is a need, that need is absolutely essential. and that there are challenges on the way, those have to be overcome.
So should the CDS be the first amongst equals, or should it be he be superior to the military hierarchy? Should he be a five-star general or a four-star general?
There are two issues. One is whether it should be a five-star, to be sure that it is superior, or you have it as a four-star, but make sure that the protocol gives that
superiority,
correct positioning, for the person to be able to function effectively. To my mind, whether it is a four-star or a five-star, the important thing is to provide that position in the protocol that allows him to discharge his functions more effectively. And I think what comes out from the Prime Minister's speech also is a positioning where he will have, the CDS will have a say over the three service chiefs.
So in the Indian system, to close this discussion, General, is it inevitable that the first couple of CDSs, they come from the army?
I don't think you need to mandate it in that manner. In fact, to be sure that, it is accepted by all the three services, more positively, it would make sense to see how well the assignment is shared by the three services. That said, I think competence is also a very important factor to be able to, take this forward, because at the end of the day, the delivery is what is going to make the difference.
So would it be fair that the selection pool, so to say, for the post of CDS, that should include CNCs and chiefs of all services? Would that be fair?
Well, how is it going to be initiated, and how it is going to be sustained into the future?
Your
question is actually quite a one of detail at the moment, right? Because ultimately it has to come from the pool of the CNCs. I don't think there is any doubt in anybody's mind. But what is it going to be immediately, and what will it be as the turnover? I think we'll have to just wait and see how they want to take it forward.
Thank you very much, General, for talking to us. There you have it, General Saha. He says he agrees this is a revolutionary decision, and the biggest step in the reform and reorganization of higher defense management. But he has a word of caution in expecting too much, and in expecting the CDS to be immediately vested with a command function over the entire military apparatus. So on that note, we are signing off. This is Vishal Thapar for SP's Digital.